So it's a great pleasure to be here in Korea again, and of course I'm very grateful for the invitation to come. As you heard, I'm an experimental neuroscientist, but having used simulation and modeling over several decades in parallel in interaction. And so, why the brain? Well, the brain is so, my brain is me, you could say. Each of us are our brain. So all you know is in your brain. All you see is seen by the brain. Happy or angry, it's all about the brain. The brain makes you remember. Each thought is in your brain. Whenever you have interesting thoughts, and the brain makes you talk. Now, humans have the facility of language, learning to speak, and that's specifically human. No other vertebrate or other creature is able to do that. And that also makes us unique in that we can talk about what happened yesterday or what we plan for tomorrow. And we can also use language in written form, and then we have a memory over millennia, or at least a millennium. So that's why the brain is doing well. And each movement, each single movement that we make, whether it's coarse walking or if it's fine as we write, it's all done by the brain. So the human brain is an electrochemical machine that enables us to think, perceive, and remember. And it consists of rather many nerve cells, as you all know, and 1,000 times more contact points between the nerve cells. So it's a very complex interaction of many cells. Fortunately, if we are to understand the brain is subdivided in different parts, different modules that subserve different functions, and they are addressable. And it's energy efficient. It runs on 20 to 30 watts, like a light bulb. And when one has tried to simulate even small parts of the brain with the granularity of the details required, then we'll need megawatts, a megawatt. That's a tried at EPFL. So essentially, biology has a trick, and it's astounding that all these nerve cells are active, all the mitochondria and everything, and still it's so energy efficient. Another aspect of the brain is that we have diseases of the nervous system in psychiatry, in neurology, etc. And the diseases of the nervous system, since many are chronic, cause no less than 35% of the cost for healthcare in North America, Japan, and Europe. So it is an important part and an important reason to try to understand more about the background. So the brain is also complex, and it's addressed by many different disciplines. Psychiatry, trying to understand what is wrong in the brain when you have schizophrenia, when you have a depression, or many other things. Neurology, when you have diseases like Parkinson's, multiple sclerosis, and so forth. But also the deficits that you see can help you understand how the brain functions. In psychology, you describe what the brain, in a simplistic manner, you describe what the brain can perform, what we can perceive and what we cannot perceive, what we can learn, how fast we can learn, how many things we can remember. And that's, of course, important. Linguistics, of course, dealing with the particular aspects of how the brain, can generate language, can learn grammar, etc. And geriatrics, the aging brain, what is required to help the aging brain still remain sound. Then you have the different fields that try to understand a little bit bottom up from cells and synapses, etc., the more complex functions. You have cognitive neuroscience, you have neurophysiology, you have molecular biology, trying to understand how the nerve cells function within themselves, and pharmacology, how different drugs can affect different processes. And then you have, of course, brain-inspired technology. I mean, we have discussed robots and what is required. And if we like to have humanoid robots, they have the same problems as a living creature. They must understand the environment and they must be able to generate the appropriate moments. So, could you start this little video showing that the brain and cortex is like a jungle? You have all the different processes that interact between the nerve cells that you see here. and so that's what we need and like to try to understand. One must also realize that in order to understand the brain, one need to understand the brain from the point of view of genes, as you see to the left, and then gradually how genes are expressed in different nerve cells, how nerve cells talk to each other, and how you have microcircuits that operate, and then full brain, and finally cognitive functions. And essentially, you can say that over the last couple of decades, we have had a phenomenal development in our knowledge on the molecular and cellular level, how nerve cells operate, how they function. We heard about dendrites and soma a little while ago, but there is all the different receptors, etc. So there has been a phenomenal development there. There has also, if you look to the right, you have the whole brain, and you have brain imaging. All of you have seen, I'm sure, images from the brain with fMRI, etc. And that tells us where things happen in the brain. If we are angry, if we are afraid, if we navigate, if we see something, different parts of the brain are activated. But there is resolution, thousands of different nerve cells. So we know where things happen, but not how. So how do we marry these two levels? And essentially, behavior is produced by networks, microcircuits of interacting nerve cells. And if you are to understand a process, let's say that you have mutation in a gene that results in a change of behavior or a disease, that's very interesting, but it's a correlation. If you should in reality understand why the gene causes the change, then you need to go from gene and what happens in the cell, what happens in the synapse, what happens in a network level, etc. So that's an important distinction. Just knowing that the gene leads to something doesn't explain everything. So, how does it come together? So, essentially, as I said before, fortunately, the brain contains modules coordinating different functions. And the brain has evolved to control action and make dynamic decisions of what to do next. And this requires, first, the brain should sense and interpret the surrounding environment, threats, prey, etc. Then I should make a decision of which action to choose. Flee, attack, or whatever. And then, having decided that, you need to implement the decision through the recruitment of different microcircuits that can help you to move. And finally, it has to be executed through hundreds of muscles in a coordinated way. And that happens in a few hundred milliseconds or 1 or 2 tenths of a second. And the brain, as many of you know, of course, has different parts that process information. We have the visual, primary visual cortex, in which signals from the eye are processed, that we know pretty much about how that functions at the first level. We have areas which helps us identify that you use just now when you listen to me, the auditory cortex. We have the sensory cortex that tells us if something is touching us. And we also have different areas in the brain that are processing speech, to understand speech. That's Wernicke's area. And we have Broca's area, which is sort of the area that is involved in generating talk that are using just now. The newborn is a sweet little survival machine. It has a few motor programs. It can cry for help. It can breathe. It can be fed. But it's a limited behavior repertoire. But after a year or so, the nervous system has matured, so we have a complex motor repertoire. And essentially, in the brain, you have different motor programs, different microcircuits that coordinate different movements. And in the spinal cord, you have the network that generate the walking movements that we just talked about, and they are in turn controlled from the brain. But the networks are in the spinal cord and determines which muscles are activated. We have, if you happen to be a fish, the spinal cord generates swimming, and you have the respiratory centers, the microcircuits that generate breathing and are active throughout life, and also driven by different metabolic demands. You have the networks that you activate when you eat, chewing, and you have networks in the another part of the higher midbrain that generates eye movements, so there is a motor map, so when you look in a given distance, you are activating the eye muscles to turn to that direction, etc. So there's a motor map. Humans have 7 different motor programs to express emotions. What this little guy, is angry, I think all of you can see. And we have then 7 motor programs for laughing, for smiling, etc. So, and these are innate, but of course what you find entertaining or what you cry and laugh at, etc., that culturally bound. So essentially having all these different motor programs, and there are many more than I listed there, then it also needs that the brain has the ability to recruit the different motor programs at a given time, to decide which motor program should be called into action. So essentially, the general design of the nervous system is common for all vertebrates. Cells, synapses, and networks. Even the forebrain is very similar. It's built in a similar way, but having much fewer neurons. And that's why why studies on fish and rodents can tell you a little bit about this guy here, the basic features of movement processing in the nervous system. But studies on rodents cannot tell you in this Einsteinian processing, so the higher cognitive functions. And as essentially, now, so what this little guy on the side here is doing, that perhaps we can tell. So essentially, we have, I think I better look in this direction now, it's better. So we have from lampreys, from the most primitive fish until mammals, the basic design of the nervous system is very similar, from cortex, the forebrain, and the rest. What is different is that that is much fewer neurons of each type. And that's, of course, facilitates the fact that you can use some rodents and fish and really make important findings that are directly relevant for humans, the basic features of humans, not cognitive functions. So the one project that has been over the last couple of years has been important in human, the Human Brain Project. It was the first of the large brain initiatives to be announced, and I will tell you a little bit about that. So it's essentially challenges in understanding the human brain. It's, of course, at different organizational level. We have the molecular level, and a lot of things have happened, synaptic plasticity, cellular, etc. We understand less the interaction between brain regions, etc. What happens in cortex, what happens in hippocampus, etc. But we understand rather much. And the whole brain and the cognitive functions is even more difficult. But I think, as I said, that the brain cannot be understood without experimentation in interaction with modeling or simulation. And that's why it's so many dynamically interacting processes, even within the single nerve cells, the ion channels, that dynamically interact. And the human brain is not too good at sorting out when there's too many things that vary at the same time. And that's where modeling is very important, to test if conclusions could be correct, etc. And to work between modeling and simulation, modeling and experimentation. And it applies to ion channels, synapse, networks, behavior, mental states, etc. So the Human Brain Project, it's seemingly rather big. It's €1 billion over 10 years, and 50% from the EU Commission. And it contains experiments, particularly focused on cognitive neuroscience and cellular molecular neuroscience. But the most important part of that is also a development of infrastructure to subserve neuroscientists globally. So it's 6 platforms, and the first is simulation. And if you like to simulate the brain, you really need to have and understand the contribution of dendrites, etc. You need to simulate neurons in a very complex way, what you call compartmental modeling. And it has been developed, I think, to a higher level than before, the simulation, the detailed simulation of this. And then we have neuroinformatics, like, if you like, Google Brain. And it's very important to collect all the different information that is available, because you have wells of information and you have psychiatrist, he may not understand molecular biology, or the finding of a molecular biologist may be very relevant for the scientist. So it's important to facilitate the interaction through databases. We have the development of new computer technology, we have high-performance computing. If we are able to simulate large parts of the brain with neuron models that are complex, then we need also high-performance computing. And robotics. Of course, a humanoid robot has very much the same problems as a living creature. It needs to interpret the environment. It needs to act on this and also make. So essentially, it's the same type of problem. And we have medical informatics. So essentially, it's an overflow of data. And data is, of course, important. But and we have in neuroscience, and this is only going to to 2011, but it's much more than 100,000 articles per year, and it's not easy to read 100,000 articles a year. If you were to read 10 articles 6 days a week, you would need 3,000 articles. So this is, of course, an overwhelming amount of information, and that's where databases are very important. So why neuroinformatics? In that I include both databases and modeling and tools, because there is an excessive accumulation of neuroscience data at all levels of analysis. It's difficult to integrate and fundamentally understand. Having the facts are absolutely important for drawing conclusions, but the mere fact that you have facts doesn't mean that you understand more. So the insight is required in what the facts may mean. So then you need to extend from genes to cognition. You have a fragmentation, as I referred to before, many dynamic, complex, interactive processes. And fortunately, when I started in the late 80s to use modeling, then the computer power was very limiting, and that's very different now. And of course, when you make a model, what is most important is that you base that on rigorous data. A model gets never better than the data that you have to put into it. So essentially, modeling is an important tool for us to help understand how calm our brain can think, act, perceive, and remember in interaction with experiments. And what this little drawing also likes to emphasize is that the brain is in principle understandable. It's an interaction between neurons and microcircuits. But I don't think that it's, and I mean that's all it is. It's just a very complex problem. It will take a long time for us to solve. But in principle, it's understandable. So at least in my view, there is no ghost in the machine. Thank you.